good stuff.
Check, check.
Yeah, yeah, see, because Richard, cleaning. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You always wait for the new model to come out, and then nobody wants the old model anymore.
Right.
Yeah, except the wiser.
Richard, we got to talk
later.
Those
who are wiser.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay, so, and I just remind people to turn off your phone. And actually, not to have it on this table, if that's possible, too.
Yeah.
That's
because
fine, yeah.
There's something funny that sometimes it causes buzzing or something.
Probably
for some.
Interference of some sort.
Yep, yep.
Got it.
Yeah, so.
I'll put it right
yeah,
down.
Yeah, and
here.
The basic thing, as we said, is very basic. It's just, you know, really, and it matters, and it mentions all of our, it's what's causing youth violence. Oh. The one thing you'll be asked before that is something about values, right? Mm-hmm. You've heard us do that. Yeah. Just what values you want to uphold in this conversation and around this issue of youth needs, right? Mm. And then we'll talk about, like, what's causing some of the youth violence and trauma, and then what are the needs, what are these programs doing to help, and what are some
so
of the
hopes. So
you're
going to ask those questions?
Yeah, I'm going to ask them.
All right.
And then we'll just go around. It'll be almost like talking circle kind of thing. And all of that comes after the intros and stuff.
Yeah, she got a little theme.
Yep, and that's the big, this is the important part.
Oh, wow. Right? Action.
Oh, yeah. Exactly. That's exactly.
Facebook is ready when you're ready.
Okay, well, we're ready. We're ready.
Mm-hmm. Flip the silver switch.
Okay.
Light goes on.
It is.
Put the clapper in front of your face. When you hit the clapper, you're on the air.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Welcome to Talking Peace with the Western New York Peace Center, being recorded here at Think Twice Radio in the home of the future, also the home of our friend and producer, Richard Wicca. Thanks, Richard. And thank you to our friends at Buff State, at WBNY, Buffalo's original alternative radio station. That's 91.3 FM. Thank you, Buff State. And being thankful and... In starting out, also reminds me of our indigenous friends, our Haudenosaunee friends, and that this is Seneca land that we're on right now, and that most of the listening area will be on, or anyone watching, that we want to remember that, you know, this is stolen land, and also remember what the Seneca do, which is to, in the very beginning, to have a ganonio, which is that really Thanksgiving address that is thankfulness for all the elements, the people that made this gathering possible, to Mother Earth, to all of the creatures, the swimming four-leggeds and flying creatures, mm-hmm. and all of the different elements in the world, and brother, sun, grandmother, moon, all the stars, and so many, the thunder beings, and also to remember the plants and the trees. So and of course the creator. So we'll remember all of that. And then if I say Nyawe, which is that thankfulness.
Nyawe.
And then you say Nyo.
Nyo. Nyo. Got it.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Got it.
Introduction.
Yeah. So it's wonderful. I love to start out that way. And then I also love to have you all here. So we're going to have a great show. We're continuing this thread of youth needs. Mm-hmm. You know, youth needs continued, and they do continue. And we have people here who are very serious about and very so wonderfully effective about pursuing those needs. So I'll just go as the Haudenosaunee, go counterclockwise around the circle.
Oh.
So we'll start with Murray Holman 6. Hi,
yes.
Murray.
How you doing, Vicki?
Oh, great. Glad to have you here. Glad to have been part of the Stop the Violence Coalition since,
yes.
I want to say, since about day two of when I moved to Buffalo.
Absolutely.
So in 2007.
Yes,
yep.
yes, and you've been
yep.
there, and you still are part of Stop
right,
the Violence
right, right, and you're still it's still going yes. strong.
You don't get kicked out the organization.
Oh, no, always, even if you try, right?
Yeah, even if you try, we don't kick you out the organization. We keep you there because networking is crucial.
Right, it's so important.
But we're here today to support you, and it's this beautiful studio, just to talk and see how we can work on some issues.
Sure.
And then we want to send a special prayer out to everyone in this nation, in this world, that, you know, going through trials and tribulations, we believe that God is the answer on right. that level as well. I left Bible study to come here.
Oh, okay.
And well, we know it's close to Easter. And
we're going to be very, yes. well, it's taking care of people is spirit. That's spiritual
yes.
work.
Yes.
You know, that's being, that's for the creator. You
Absolutely.
Know, it's all, we're all part of that creation.
Balanced off. Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
we need.
Yeah, so that's what we're here to
follow
yeah.
that love.
So I'm blessed to be here as well, you know, and to my wife and to my family, just stay tuned. Let's see what we can do.
Well, thanks. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Murray. Mm-hmm. And so from there, I'll also mention Ayana McCoy.
Hey.
And so, Ayana, thank you so much for coming. Ayana is also, let's see, the community organizer and administrative coordinator at Stop the Violence Coalition, as well as having your own
business, Bloom Matter Botanics.
Bloom Matter Botanics.
Yes.
Botanics, that's right. That's right. That's right. And all kinds of community garden work that you're doing.
Yeah.
And not to mention that I met you just this weekend at the Wakanda Alliance.
Yeah, sure
which,
did.
Which just turns me over to
what is the Wakanda
Anthony Price, who I'm going
to
say is the program director for the famed Wakanda Alliance that we so dearly love.
Indeed.
Thank you, Ace,
cool,
for
thank
coming.
You. Thanks for having me. So, to answer your question, Mr. Murray,
yes.
the Wakanda Alliance is a reading comic book literacy group.
Right.
So we do activities as well, crafting activities.
Mm-hmm.
It's an intergenerational space, so places mm-hmm. like Ayana and Miss mm-hmm. Vicky mm-hmm. and Miss Jayana, or Miss Shana, who was just here, and Little mm-hmm. Noah, who
right.
was also just here. They can
right.
all meet in the same place,
right. and
read comics together, and be able to craft together and
Whoa.
Do
right.
fun things together.
It's
so.
Really cool.
Yeah.
And wasn't Naila there? Was she
yeah.
there too?
Yeah, yeah. She came a little too. Bit after, but yeah.
Oh, okay, she was there a little,
I got a bunch
yeah.
of grandkids
right,
that
right,
need
right.
to be in that room.
Yes, they do.
I got like 24
Bring them. Bring
them. Yes, come on. Bring him. Yeah. And it's absolutely free, so I know that's
easy. Talk about that space.
If you can come.
They can come.
Yes.
Are you kidding? It's for them.
We got a van. We can
it's
put four
of them.
Y'all have to hear about that space that it's inside of, because
oh,
that was
beautiful.
Really transformative.
Yeah. For it, so it's King Urban Life Center. So that's
the
corner of Rich and Genesee. A church that got converted into a college / community center. So. Beautiful space, 40 wide
cool.
open.
Yes.
So we got our blow up screen and all that stuff. So it's a great place to
What's
be.
What's your
in.
Time?
12 to 2 p.m. every second. Sorry, say yeah, 12 to 2:30 p.m. every second and fourth Saturday of the month.
My family needs to know about this.
They do.
Sitting at home doing nothing.
Mm-hmm. They do. You know? And yeah. while we're at it, I can't help mentioning then Peace Jam.
Yes.
So
yeah.
Peace Jam, which is every Thursday, not Thursday the 14th. But every other Thursday through to like May 19th, it'll be 3 to 5 at the Meriwether Library.
Great.
Okay.
So we're happy to mention that. But so it really makes us, before we dive in, and we are, really already are diving into youth needs because we love our youth.
Yeah.
But before we do, I want us to just remember to our values. So just to uphold, you know, like, why are we even here? And this is why we so already started diving into it.
Mm-hmm.
Is so what are the values that we want to uphold, both in the conversation and especially in this issue of youth needs?
Mm-hmm.
So we'll just go around
so
like
can
that.
We like skip yeah. Yeah, and then go boom, boom. Because I don't want to always be first. You try to
well,
be
you know,
first
no,
all the
you
time.
Know why? Only because the Haudenosaunee.
Oh.
You know what? On the other side of the world, they go around
the other way.
The other way.
Oh, wow.
So this is what the indigenous people do. So I'm putting.
I'm trying to learn. I'm
because
trying
the
to
fact
that's
that,
a cipher culture.
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
That because I was on the other side,
mm-hmm. yeah.
and I did see that they did it the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
So they went count. They went clockwise, mm-hmm. whereas on this side of the world, you go counterclockwise. So I think there might be something there. But if you don't mind going first, you'll just,
yeah.
everyone will get their turn.
Okay, I won't,
yeah.
I want to hear from you.
You don't have
first.
To go for long.
The energy is there.
Wow.
So I can be prepared. You got me.
No, you're prepared.
Me so much.
Okay, I'll go first. Because I usually use the my two very favorite when I have to ask for values
mm-hmm.
are truth and love.
Mm.
Truth and love, because love is the ultimate value.
Right.
And real love includes wisdom. Mm-hmm. But certainly truth is the key ingredient too. Because we can love and love, but if we're not going to talk about the truth and even recognize it, then we're not going to get very far. So and that's what Dr. King said. I believe that unarmed truth and unconditional love will have the final word. So that is why I want to uphold those. I'll bring those up. I usually bring them up at the end, but I'll bring them up at the start.
Uh-oh.
And now you're next.
So values. One value.
Just, mm-hmm.
One value is loyalty.
Mm-hmm.
Loyalty to God, not to man.
Right.
That's very important to have.
Sure. Absolutely.
Because we try to be loyal to each other, but we have to be loyal to Him first, and then everything would take its place. Love is always my second passion because I love the community. I love my family, and I love my bloodline, where it's going and where I'm going to be in the future. And I love that I have youth, young people that's willing to take the baton and move forward. And I can rest easy like Brother Simba. When you was mentioning like Martin Luther King, I had a lot of great leaders here, George K. Arthur, people here from this city, Jesse Nash Center and all that, part of that era that, you know, never get mentioned anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what it is. But the loyalty is to Him first and then man second.
Sure.
Yes.
Thank you. Wonderful, Murray. Thank you, Six. And Ayana.
Yes. my values.
Yeah, just a value, one you want us to remember in this connection. Or one of them.
I'm very big on yoga, so I have to say mindfulness is really big.
Oh, yeah.
And I want that to remain in this conversation.
Absolutely.
Second, and all, just gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
When you have gratitude, you have consciousness, you have mindfulness, and when you have gratitude for anything or any being, you automatically have love. So and respect.
Right.
So mindfulness and gratitude.
Beautiful.
For this conversation.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Excellent. Like those.
Yeah.
I would say communication, because without communication, whether you have a negative or a positive, you still have to communicate with somebody about something. You have to be able to communicate an emotion.
Yes.
If you're communicating also, not just with yourself or a fellow man, but with God too, you have to understand the communication both ways. You have to be able to listen and give off.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with the nature and the spirits of the earth. You have to be able to give off the right and then take in the right way. So communication is always one of my big ones.
Oh,
sure.
That is
and
very
that leads
big.
Into everything else to me.
Yes, so. Yes, it is so critical.
Mm-hmm.
It's the first step. If only we would do that. If we would actually, we were just talking when we were talking a little bit before about, you know, some of the existential threats and things.
Mm-hmm.
Communication would be a big, not the only thing, but it would be a huge. Yeah, it's so needed and so important. So important. So we've gone around with that. So let's just talk a little bit about. Well, first of all, I want to recognize Joni Russ is thanking us, is saying hi and thanking us. We thank you, Joni, for watching, for listening,
hi, Joni.
And wishing us a happy Passover, Easter, spring, etc.
Yeah.
And I think we want to bless the people in Ukraine and
and
all the other war torn spots.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I just wrote an article in the Latino Village, why we should care about Ukraine, and I want to say because we should care about every part of the world that is under attack, and that includes Yemen and actually still Afghanistan in a different way. Now they're under economic collapse.
Africa.
And Africa in so many ways.
Yeah, Egypt. Congo.
Congo, it persists.
It's ridiculous over there right now.
But the one thing about Ukraine, and it's not because it's white people, even though, and it's not because they're trying to, you know, they're talking about it on the news every night. It's because you have two nuclear armed sides.
This side.
And that's what we were talking about before the show.
Mm-hmm.
So that makes it a tremendous existential threat because wouldn't even need to worry about climate catastrophe, which is going on, if we have nuclear winter setting in.
Yeah.
So we do care about Ukraine, and certainly our hearts go out to the people who are suffering like mad there and in so many parts of the world. So we just have to do a lot better with our communicating and our loving and our mindfulness.
Exactly. You know,
and our gratitude.
Exactly.
Yes, and all those, and our community, because it's a world community that needs to band together for our youth. So I just want to mention that, you know, many of you will have heard this before, but I always think about, there was an African tribe that had, instead of asking, how are you, they used to ask, how are the children? Because they felt like, as soon as you know how the children are, you know how things are. And we know that even for those of us, and I'm going to say, is for those of us who don't have children, still know that if the state of our children is not good, the state of our world is terrible.
True.
So that is, it's the biggest, in every way, wrong and existential threat that we could have. So how is it that our children are, how are they suffering? And let's talk about how has it come about that they are suffering the ways they are suffering. So
I'm not starting. No.
Oh my God.
You don't have to.
I think that a lot of youth have issues. So usually a lot of older generations will blame like technology.
Mm-hmm.
And technology is just boom, 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 always moving, always evolving.
Mm.
And it's hard to keep up. Like even me being 31 years old, I'm still like learning like how certain things are working, and new things are popping up all the time.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so I think it's getting to a point where the youth have so much autonomy that they're kind of phasing out what others are doing in their community. And then when people want to go out and fetch them, they're a little too aggressive, or they don't know how to communicate properly in order to address what a child might be feeling or what they're going through. They're just kind of saying, stop using that, or stop doing that, or stop using that, or we stop using that app, get off the game, that type of thing. But it's like, let's see if we could see if we can help them use it better. You know what I'm saying? Because it's not going anywhere. You know, so how can you use this app better? How can you use this video game better? Make your own game. Make your own app. You know what I'm saying? So help them try to get back into developing and just being aware. You know what I'm saying? Being aware that you're not just the adult because you're older. You have dominance over them. No, you are a part of their life and a part of their system. And you have to know where your role is.
Guidance.
Yeah, for sure. Understanding you're a guidance person, but understand they're human and they're going to make mistakes. They're going to be attached to certain things that might be negative for them. And that's all right. You know, so I think that there has to be understanding on some of the older generation side.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. What are some other factors that any of you see in what's troubling for our youth and for us? I mean, it doesn't mean it's only for the youth, that it's because they're suffering.
I'm the youth too.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, first of all, who is youth? You know, I mean, if you're certainly relative to some of us, definitely you and you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you willing to say how old you are?
I'm 24.
Okay. Oh, so you're definitely youth. Yeah, we're definitely on the
youth. Wow. Don't do me like that.
No. That's not bad.
I just turned 24.
Well, I am in my Social Security cohort.
Oh, my goodness. I looked at Social Security.
I'm past. I mean, into it. Some of the other things, because I can mention a few, and first of all, I'm going to mention the obvious one that is not the only. I guess I have to mention intergenerational trauma.
Mm-hmm.
I want to mention that
because
that is so
That's
critical.
A big one.
That is a huge one, and actually, you know, I think when we talk about, I talk about broken alert systems. So anybody who watches this show very much will have heard me talk about it before, because, you know, I feel like, well, fine, you know, there's we can talk about mental health. I don't talk about mental health. I talk about broken alert system, because fight, flight, freeze, if it's on all the time, means
you're
it's not working.
Mode.
Right. And so people are, that's a broken alert system.
Mm-hmm.
That means that, as you say, survival mode, or that fight, flight, freeze is going on all the time for kids and for adults.
Mm-hmm.
And traumatized people, communicate a traumatized worldview to their children. So I want to say, if we say post traumatic slave disorder, if we say racism, you know, and all of the hardship and trauma that racism, you know, when we say even very middle class, that perfectionism and all over competition, which is the hugest shame generator, and shame is the subtle trauma. When we don't see another trauma, that would be it. So for all of those reasons, we all are suffering under that. Anybody who says they're not at all, mostly, I don't believe them, but, you know, because also then stress, just the pain, stress of living, of trying to make ends meet, trying to do all
so,
the...
So, your question was for the youth.
Yeah, but I said right. For the youth doesn't mean that it doesn't affect other people.
True.
So the youth, I think that what I was going to say is, so we all have that going on. They have all that going on separately and also communicated from the older generation.
Well, I think that what we're well. Missing is that we're not listening to the youth.
Right.
My generation,
right.
I'm 57. Mm-hmm. 58, just turned
mm-hmm.
58.
Mm-hmm.
We're not listening. We think we know the plan. This mm-hmm. new generation of youth, as we can call it, they're smarter. They're much greater in thinking, you know,
mm-hmm.
in math and things like that. They just went through COVID.
Right.
They have obstacles in front of them that the parents have never experienced.
Mm.
And I can give it to you plain and simple. My daughter works for Geico. Now she's at home on a computer. And she has four kids.
Mm.
And they're around. They're missing their mother. Shh, be quiet. She's at work.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? So now it's going to be something that's going to be missed, because before you were going to work, leaving the house.
Right.
So now this generation that's getting ready to come up, these 2 and 3 year olds, it's going to be different from this generation that's here right in this room
mm-hmm,
now.
Mm-hmm.
Their thinking is going to be different.
Mm-hmm.
So if they're getting involved in violence because they're always sitting at home, they're more at home playing the video games now
mm-hmm.
or the tablets from school or whatever. They're so in tune with the computer that they might miss out on skills that the hug or whatever they were getting before, because
mm-hmm.
mom or dad is at work
mm-hmm.
in this new thing that we have to be coping with. And then when we deal with violence in our community right now,
right.
With the schools and things like that there, mm-hmm. It's not with the guns anymore. It's with cultural violence. It's knives. It's certain type of rituals that might be done differently than from what we were experiencing as black folks and white folks
mm-hmm.
in the city of Buffalo
mm-hmm.
Or across this nation. We getting new people coming to America that has a different type of violence.
Mm-hmm.
We getting kids that's coming that getting off of trains and they experienced already shells and bombings and things like
mm-hmm,
that our
mm-hmm.
kids haven't. So now when they mix with our kids and things happen, we cannot figure it out. So we have to go into the mental state. We have to figure this out psychological more than ever before. When we were just talking about the gun, we can figure out black man shoots a black man, boom, we can figure that out. Right, we can say let's go after the gun manufacturers, but now the cultural
we're not even allowed to do.
But now the cultural thing mm-hmm. is happening, and we have to rethink this thing through. So that's what I'm saying to you. We have to start listening to the youth, the babies. We have to start listening to the youth. When you have a party and you have over 150 kids go to a party, and somebody comes through there and spray it up.
Mm.
When I say spray it up, that's shooting.
Right. No.
Is that the norm?
Mm-hmm.
Seems to be
mm-hmm.
when we get together or when we go to the mall, the first thing kids do is instead of going there to shop and go home, they go there to fight
mm-hmm.
across the nation. So now we as adults here and say, well, we can put Stop the Violence, we can put Western or Peacemakers, we can put all these groups there and be like, and then you're so... Vicky has one out there, and just talk to the kid, and you'd be surprised what they'll tell you.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well,
like, wow.
I want to say you are so right mm-hmm. about how important listening. When you said about communication, I was thinking, you know, we do plenty of work around listening in most of the workshops we do,
mm-hmm.
but and around communications. But the big thing, listening, why we have two ears and one mouth, that kind of thing,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
that, you know, how important deep listening really is. Ayanna, what would you say about some of the things affecting our youth?
The two responses were very fitting, but I'm also just coming off of doing after-school programming over on High Street at the Moot Center in partnership with Home Beneath Our Feet.
Great.
And I got to interact with children from 11 years old to 16, and I think it really brought me back, and it humbled me to when I was a child and when I was a teenager and a preteen. And I think that the same problems still occur, you know, just different setting and different day and age. But I think the lack of autonomy and the lack of being able to make your own decisions is a big one, a big effective piece for youth, especially when your life is in the hands of someone who also does not have things figured out. Someone who also fears for their life and their safetyhood. So I think just being able to go to school and not feel safe, and then you come home where you have to transit home by yourself and not feel safe, and then you get home and you don't feel safe, where is the control group there? Where do you have control at all? You know, you don't make your own money. You don't have control over your own time. You don't have control over the clothes of your back or the food that you put in your mouth. It's all just lack of control, lack of autonomy.
That's
a big one.
You're making me think so much of parenting. And actually, I taught parenting, which is, you know, I can't believe I did, but that was my job. I wasn't a parent, but I was child, I was a social worker, so there were things I learned. But one of the things, freedom within limits, that one of the things is really, you know, back to, we can't teach what we don't know, and we can't help our kids get things that we don't know. We you know, we're limited by what we don't know.
I learned how to work on cars without a book, just getting it, watching it one time, boom, got it. And that's what I'm saying. Our culture, we learn from just watching.
Right.
So stuff that we don't know, we pick it up. So for some reason,
I'm just saying that as parents, you know, that our, you know, first of all, we're all imperfect, and this is a difficult society that is warped in lots of ways, that is not functioning well in terms of justice, real justice, right? In terms of economic justice.
Hasn't it always been that way? I hate to interrupt you, but has it not always been that way?
Well,
regardless of the increase in technology, a toaster is technology. A toaster was latest technology when it first came out, you know what I mean? Inequality, though, economic inequality, racial inequality was always prevalent within the United States. So I don't think that's like a justification in any sense to say that, this world is dwindled. Like, it's always been dwindled for a certain person that looks a certain way or does a certain thing or has a certain job. There are always impediments. There are always hindrances within one's life. But I think when you know what something does look like, or when you have experienced a certain atmosphere and you bear children, it's almost common sense to me to know that you don't want your child to go through a certain thing that you've done, or, you know, you can't teach what you don't know. I disagree with that.
Well, all I mean is if you don't know a healthy way to feel inside yourself, then it's going to be very hard for you to help your children develop that feeling of self-love or of respect for other people. You know, when we, so that's all I mean. I don't mean, in a literal way that, it's so the violence that kids are
finding love in violence. They're finding love in violence.
I think also some of them finding love where love should be.
Right.
So what I was going to jump into was the village isn't there. You know,
uh-huh.
We talked about intergenerational. So somebody who's my age, somebody who's Mr. Murray's age, somebody who's a young.
We're actually a little ladder here.
Right.
I'll tell you.
But even like the in between, like, mm-hmm. you know, we don't have the safety. Our kids aren't safe when they go outside.
Right. Yeah.
Outside ain't safe.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And we know that. So we're trying to keep them inside.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Instead of trying to reach down and build, like, what group needs to be the ones who are going to protect the outside? Mm-hmm. Like, my child, I don't have any kids, but my child should be cool going to my neighbor's house.
Yes.
We don't have to trust either, right? We don't can't trust our neighbors.
That
we
is so
our neighborhood,
huge. Yes.
Right? But before we could, right, Murray,
yes,
back
yes.
in the day, you could.
Absolutely.
For the most
Jones,
part,
Mr. Jones.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Yeah, they're a network of information.
Right.
And
right.
they have the power to discipline the child so the child knows that mm-hmm. this person needs to be respected. This person needs to be respected.
Right.
This piece of person needs to be listened to.
Right.
Because my family trusts this person, so I can trust this person.
Yep.
Right.
Not just with, like, my awareness, but also with my thoughts.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think that's a really strong component that makes a difference in how our kids are growing up.
Right. Mm. So that's back to you can't teach what you don't know. You can't communicate what you
don't
feel. Right. So if you live in a very distrustful, for reason or for no reason,
mm-hmm.
then we communicate that to our kids and they will grow up in that kind of mindset. Right. So
no,
this is why.
Not necessarily.
Intergenerational, not necessarily.
When you, I personally,
that's
I think
book
about,
theory.
Yeah,
I think.
When you personally think about the amount of influences that a child experiences, I mean, not just from the home. You spend 8 hours a day in school as a child. That is 8 hours of your life. That's just as much as 40 hours a week as a work week. You know,
uh-huh.
So you're for the most of a child's life, you're spending more time, if like the same amount of time. In school or with outside environmental factors and forces as you are with your parents.
Well,
my
experience is that the parents have a big influence on the child's worldview. That's just my experience. Maybe that's not what you've experienced.
Well, because when we're talking about parents in the community that we're
mm-hmm.
from,
mm-hmm.
How many
it's
parents
grandmother.
Are actually parenting?
Yes,
exactly.
It's
well,
not,
back to the village.
Yeah, it's,
what
it's
you
not
said
the,
about
the village.
It's not the village,
it's not
though.
The village.
It's the absence
it's
of...
Absence of the village, and now we have a grandparent or a foster parent
mm-hmm.
coming in, showing different views on things, and this kid
sure.
always can't figure it out where he fits in until he gets to... 13, 14 years
exactly.
old. So that's why I came with the love of gangs or getting in violence
mm-hmm.
because those gangs show them love
and
now
camaraderie.
Here we come. And so now this kid is wound up and he could be a smart kid.
Mm-hmm.
He could be a smart young lady
mm-hmm. sure.
or young lady and then get caught up in this. And then
right.
now when they come to school, they try to get out of it and then the teachers can't understand Johnny is getting 90s and all that here, but he's a thug.
Mm-hmm.
Hold
and
on.
That's
that
if
don't
they care.
Yes, that's
if they care.
And they don't come from the same background either, so they're not even
they
looking for
the art part.
Exactly.
Now they figure out he's drawing and he's doing all this stuff,
mm-hmm.
and then they try to pull to him, and then he's saying, I can't go with you because you don't know where I'm coming from, where I live. And you've been to homes, Vicky,
mm-hmm.
when young people go through trials and tribulations, and you get to their home, it's different.
Mm-hmm.
Or you get to their home, the house is clean. The grandparents on top of them, and they said, "Where's your mom? Well, she passed away.
Mm-hmm.
Where's your dad? Well,
right,
he
right.
was murdered.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right,
that's
right,
what
right.
we. But not, they're teaching themselves. They're smart enough to teach themselves how to get past where they at. If you put my grandson in the room and his little baby sister is crying, he knows to go to grab her and hug her and say, "What do you want?
Sure.
You know, because it's already been entombed in his
but
DNA.
But that's what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So that is there. That is there.
Mm-hmm. But when it's not there, that's when we have a
and
problem.
And when it's not there, that's back to, you know, whether it's being conveyed or not. You know, what kind. The first thing that a child is figuring out is their environment safe or not safe? Do I feel safe in my environment or not?
Yes.
And that is going to be affected by, I said parents, and I shouldn't have said parents, the caregiver, the environment that they're in. So that, I stand also, corrected.
Also the adjacent environments, too. It's
sure.
It's not always just the
absolutely.
House.
No,
church,
no.
It could be church figuring out problems.
Oh, sure.
Just adding on to what you're saying.
Yeah, there's all that.
School, it's the church. It could be
absolutely.
Just the neighborhood itself. So.
Those are also big
which
factors.
Is all now locked down.
Mm-hmm.
COVID
right.
has locked down
right.
how we worship, mm-hmm. how we communicate,
right.
how we have this meeting here.
Right.
It has put us into a mind state that we can't figure out right now. Grown-ups
mm-hmm.
can't figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
1 week, you either quarantine, the next week you're out of quarantine.
Sure.
Some
right.
churches still, you're practicing COVID rules and some not.
Mm-hmm.
Government, and I went into the court building that, mind you, I went to the city court building, had to have a mask on. Went to the federal court building, didn't have to have a mask on.
Right.
So I'm like, wait
right,
a minute, hold
right,
on.
Right.
So, you know, we got this stuff going on in our heads. What do you think this kid is going through?
Sure.
And that's where you're at when you ask the question about
mm-hmm.
what do we think is our kids listening to what? They got so much coming at them, they can't figure it all out.
Oh, absolutely.
So much, yeah.
yeah.
And another, back to the COVID, I want to say, you know, as we were talking about the village, you know, just being around people, being with people, you know, so that's coming back, thank God. But we know that that's the big, you know, we're social animals.
Mm-hmm.
We need to be around
yeah.
people. And so for kids who've had now 2 years of being alone a lot of the time or very restricted in terms of just being with their friends, being with their peers,
right.
you know, it's big. It's huge for kids.
But then the violence still stays there. See, because what we just had recently was crime went down when COVID was
mm-hmm.
in play.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Soon as COVID went back onto the scale of us going out socializing,
mm-hmm.
those beef came back.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of like got us in the clear, but then it's put us back to the beef. I can remember driving my car down
mm-hmm.
Genesee
mm-hmm.
and Fillmore, and it was beating this girl to death. And I jumped out my car with the Stop the Violence van, and I broke it up, and I called 911. And you know what they said?
What?
Does she have COVID? I'm like,
oh my
I don't even
God.
Know this
wow.
girl. I don't even know her. I need help right now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Well, sir, is anybody with COVID? They was already structured to do
oh
the
my
government
God.
On trying to not come and get me assistance. And I'm telling them who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And this girl is beaten to death almost.
Mm-hmm.
And they keep worrying about, does she have COVID? And these rules are going on. It's just like when you call, and I just mentioned today, Vicky, I called SSI, Social Security.
Right.
I was on the phone for two
yeah.
hours
yeah,
waiting
ridiculous.
To get through because our government and everyone now is, quote, not working at the positions or the structural building they're working at home
mm-hmm.
and it's being redirected. So everything that we're doing, these are what our kids is going through right now.
Right.
So they like, well, I can't talk to Miss Vicky. I can't talk to this brother. I can't talk to this sister
mm-hmm.
because
right.
guess what? I can't get through to them.
Mm-hmm. Who really cares? Who
really
cares? I gotta say, I tutored a young woman. She was 16, just yesterday,
mm-hmm.
and she sat down, and I was grateful that she was able to really see me as a control group and release what she had, and she told me almost everything, and everything that she told me was just wrapped around her lack of safety.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Right.
She can't focus on schoolwork because this family member is going through this or her mom is going through that.
Right.
And I'm trying to tell her respectfully, none of this has anything to do with you. What can you control in your life? What do you have control over in your life? And the things that she has control over in her life, education, you know,
mm-hmm.
just eating right, those things.
Mm-hmm. Somewhat,
she doesn't even truly have control
somewhat,
over that.
If she has that control.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know?
Right, right.
She, this particular female, she went to McKinley.
Mm-hmm.
McKinley just got shot up.
No, mm-hmm. no help.
Mm-hmm.
She told me out of her mouth, teachers are killing themselves. They're not coming back to school. She had one class. I was supposed to be tutoring her in math. She had one class. The teacher completely left.
Mm-hmm.
Shut down the whole class. There was no assignments on the blackboard. There was no assignments.
Mm.
It's April.
Right. Right.
How
right.
does that, you know what I mean? How
right.
does that affect a child's mindset toward education?
Oh, sure.
Toward autonomy, you
mm-hmm.
know? Being able to read and do basic math is like gold,
mm-hmm.
you know, to do anything else.
Right.
Where's the foundation?
So I think we, you know, we're looking at so many reasons why youth and people are stressed out, and especially, or have been, and, you know, and somehow it compounds, you know, with the things that are really happening in this world, and they really are happening.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk some about some of the programs that we all are involved in, mm-hmm. different ones that are available for supports for our youth. Mm-hmm. So, we were just talking about the Wakanda
Alliance. Start with the Wakanda Alliance. That is gold. Yes.
And actually, one thing I want to say, especially about the educational element that is very strong in that program. Mm-hmm. The first one I went to was on the African origins of mathematics.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Was fantastic.
Yes.
Yeah. So
beautiful.
You already know Nelson and all that.
Yes,
so.
I know Nelson. We worked together.
Yeah. So there's just so many things we could talk about. I'm like, Black Panther, for me growing up, just looking at, you know, what it looked like to be a Black king, and imagining what that looked like. Imagine a nation that was untouched by colonialism and whatnot,
right?
And how powerful that was for me. You know what I'm saying? Even now as an adult, in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, what would T'Challa do in this situation? What would a king do? What would somebody I look up to do in this situation? So I was trying to, like, the tribe and I, we've been trying to bring that energy to the new youth, because they don't really get into comics like that.
Right.
So giving them a platform where they can read the comic, learn about different cultures and whatnot, and just know that this idea, you have the power to do so much. Like, who would have thought this comic that was invented in the 1960s by white dudes would have so many Black people come to bring their talents to create a movie that broke records and did all these incredible things.
Yes.
And then the places that they're taking the information from are real places, real cultures from around the world throughout history.
Right.
Beautiful, whether it's science, technology, math, like all these different things.
Right.
So just knowing that there's more out there, and that when you find these things out, keep the conversation going. Being able to take a fictional story, or even take a myth and turn it into something with new energy. You know what I'm saying? That's what folklore is.
Yeah.
Right? A lot of us grew up on folklore and nursery rhymes and whatnot.
Right.
But but these things, if you can take something like that and flip it into a story, you can make a movie. You can make a book.
Absolutely.
You can do, you know, all types of things.
Right.
So just knowing that there's so much out there.
Well, that's like parables. Mm-hmm. That's the meaning in the story.
Yeah.
You know, and we all have our own story, too. Actually, that's one intervention I just love.
Yeah.
That creativity of having kids make their own books, or you make your own books for the kids.
Adults, you know? Too. That's the thing, too. Like, with it being in a generational space, the kid can see how the adult creates, the adult can see how the kids create.
Right.
They can create together.
Right.
They can, you know, put their ideas together and create something beautiful. Mm-hmm. So I think that's one of the strengths, one of the big strengths of the Wakanda Alliance program.
I'm actually coming right now.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Right now, I got it.
Oh, that's so wonderful.
Right, because it's not like, you know, you take your kid to a karate class, you drop them off, you leave.
Boom.
You know what I'm saying? Or you
see
them
later.
Off. Yeah, right. So you get to stay in that space. Go ahead, Vicky.
No, I was just going to say, because one of the kids did make a book.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah, did make a book.
I didn't even tell them to make a book.
In fact, I want to say, I think it was the one who just left.
It was Noah,
Noah, I thought it
the
was.
The activity
I
was.
I thought I remembered it,
So the activity was, in the comic we were reading about Storm, she's a goddess and all that, plants, Environmental Justice Month, Earth Day is a few weeks away.
Yeah,
right.
So that's a nominee. Yeah, it's a nominee.
She's tingling now. What?
So we were just like, let's have them create their own plants. So,
right.
But also draw from when it's a seed to when it's a full-grown plant.
Wow.
What does it need to grow? What what does it do? Do you
this
need
is coming
it?
Up?
No, this already happened.
Oh,
he did.
But I can.
We just had it.
Yeah. But we can always do stuff.
We got Earth Day coming up, right?
It's Earth Month, right? That's why.
Yeah. We say it's Earth Month, for sure.
Yeah.
But so like, what does it respond? What does it need to grow? What do we do when we eat it or roll it up, or, you know, whatever we do with it? Again, so one of the kids, they said, all right, I'm gonna do a flip book. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know where they got the idea for a flip book from, but they did it. You know what I'm saying?
So. And actually, that was one of the beautiful things. Mm-hmm. One of the many beautiful things was to see how each child use their own creativity. Mm-hmm. So there was a basic instruction,
but
then each one did a very different thing.
One kid did a 3D model, one of them cut the piece and glued it on top of another piece, and I was like, sprouted up. Like, I was like,
right.
So it was great. It's always great.
It really is.
So that's what I was saying to you about the bloodline and stuff that these kids have already, mm-hmm. instilled them already, mm-hmm. because their forefathers already had this in them. This is how we lived. Yeah. This is how we communicated. This is how we traveled.
One kid asked about what's DNA, because he mm-hmm. saw the word DNA in a comic like he sure. heard it before. He didn't mm-hmm. know what it was. So then right. I broke it down, but from a perspective of somebody who looks at him like he's a young black king.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know what I'm saying? And just knowing that your ancestry, your DNA is made of something that's beyond your wildest dreams.
Oh, you told him
the but reverse. You are the wildest dream. Because right. you're the reverse. Like,
yes.
you're imagining what who's before you. That's your wildest dream. Mm-hmm. Right. They all imagine you
yes.
coming this far.
Yes.
Right.
So that's you're their wildest dream.
Kid asked me, right. I would say deoxyribonucleic acid. That's what
it's like. That's yeah.
what it is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So,
wow.
Yeah, yeah, it's an incredible thing.
I
yeah.
see. I feel his energy. I mean, it's fire.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Whenever you ask me about it,
fire,
yes.
yeah.
And also, I want to mention powerful. That you also do tutoring or help for kids in photography and teaching martial arts.
I
right?
do photography oh, wow. as a craft. I don't
as
teach
a craft.
I don't teach photography yet, but
right. oh, okay.
I'm a martial artist as well too.
Right.
So
wow.
talking, so I do capoeira. Capoeira, oh, yeah. Southern Brazil. It's a Afro-Brazilian martial art.
Uh-huh.
Came over from Africa.
It's dance too.
In that, right.
Yeah.
yeah. Dance, music. It's the yeah. only martial art that involves dance
see,
and music together.
And say it again. How
you
how
know a lot
it?
Of it.
Yes, it's the only martial art that involves dance and music
yes.
together, along with the
it
fighting
like,
techniques.
Yeah.
As
and
well.
It's called
capoeira.
Capoeira.
I think somebody wrote something to you, Vicky, on there. Did you see that? Right.
Yeah, we've seen that, and actually,
is that
I
the
mean,
same one?
It's the well, it's actually the same thing that you said. That,
okay.
The yeah, definitely. Joni is
oh,
right
yeah,
that
Joni.
That gangs do, you know, kids mm-hmm. appeal to kids so that they have a connection.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, for
right.
that love connection, or especially if there's
that
problems.
Belonging, yeah.
If they're not getting everything they need at home,
right.
that's one of the problems. And that's what we were, that's
mm-hmm.
actually what we were
great.
Just saying. But thank you for pointing it out, and thank you for writing it up on the board, Joni. Thanks.
Okay. Anyway. So growing up, Mr. Murray, I know you remember like the Kung Fu flicks.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? How that
sure.
boom was.
Yes.
Sure.
A lot of us didn't know that there was martial arts outside of Asia. You
yes.
know what I'm saying? To
right.
think that there were actually a lot of Africans everywhere in Africa, they were practicing martial arts.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And so this seed was carried over from there in Brazil, survived slavery,
yes.
and now it's here in the present day. So that's the martial art
wow.
that I'm teaching.
And it was used. It was used
yeah.
because mm-hmm. of violence amongst blacks.
Mm-hmm.
That black people got together, Black Panthers,
yeah.
Organizations learned martial arts
mm-hmm.
because they were getting beat up so much. So they
mm-hmm.
learned techniques on how to protect themselves
yeah.
and also how to defend themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That era came out. Then we seen our movies, our Jim Kelly
mm-hmm.
Movies,
oh, yeah.
Bruce Lee movies,
oh, yeah.
things like that there. But that came out of that because black folks were getting beat up so much.
Mm-hmm.
And we was on this level of, okay, nonviolence, but we was taking a beating.
Mm-hmm.
And then
mm.
some of our group said, no. You must protect yourself
uh-huh.
and you must defend
right.
yourself.
They started outlawing
sure.
weapons too.
Yes,
in New York State, they
yes.
outlawed nunchucks and all these
and
kung fu weapons.
And it's on
wow.
the record still
no,
right now.
No, they
nunchucks
oh,
is on there.
They're not on there anymore.
Yes, it is. I just came out of class.
Oh, you did?
This week.
Oh, word. All right.
Still
they put
there.
It back on there. Because
yeah.
before COVID,
the stars,
they took it right off.
And
so.
The stars.
Uh-huh.
They're not allowed.
They're not allowed. They're
right.
in the records, in the penal law system. They're
okay.
still on the record
mm-hmm. I see
for
right.
not having them.
Okay.
Brass knuckles, things like that.
So
there.
If I get caught,
wow.
I'm in trouble?
Yes, you are.
Well, I just ain't got to get caught. Listen, so the thing about capoeira, man, they were fighting back in their system, but they also had minimal resources. So they were
right.
they took their knowledge that they adapted from their generations
mm-hmm.
on natural knowledge. They worked the lands. They knew how to navigate the lands.
Yeah.
They knew how to retreat into the lands. What's poison? What's potion? How to
mm-hmm.
make those? How to poison masters? How to be spies sneaking onto the
mm-hmm.
plantations?
Mm-hmm.
So they're all about that liberation. So,
wow.
So even if you know I happen to get caught with a nunchucks, I'm still going to teach some kids how to use them because it's something else besides just the two fists, and it's less than a gun.
Yeah,
you know
sure.
what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You get hit with a nunchuck, you don't want to fight no more. That'll
no.
take the fight right out of you. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But also just the diligence and the discipline it takes to use something, but know when to use it, when not to use
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
You know, so that's also a beautiful thing. But yeah, so teaching capoeira, teaching martial arts is something my contribution
discipline.
To the village.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha.
Absolutely.
Oh,
wonderful.
Beautiful.
Well, I'm interested how it's connected with dance also.
Yeah, I mean, we're African.
Yeah.
Right. No, well, I
mean, Rizzo,
I mean, I'm a dancer, too,
so,
so that's why I'm
yeah, Vicky,
interested.
You do dance. You do. She take her shoes off and dance, too.
Oh, yeah.
My
I can't wait to see that next time. Okay, so there's instruments in capoeira, a bidimbau, drums, and which like a pandeiro, which is like a tambourine instrument. These instruments are used in conjunction with training and then also with the practice. So when we get together, we play the instrument, somebody's singing, they're singing songs about ancestry or they're teaching a parable through song. And then there's two people in the middle who aren't trying to knock each other's heads off or score points on one another. They're just expressing each other through movement. So there might be a takedown. Somebody might get hit, but that's on them because, you know, you're taught to dodge in capoeira.
Right.
But it's a conversation, which is why communication, again, is one of my biggest principles. So if you want to have a more aggressive conversation, sure. If the other person responds, then they might take you down. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Especially if you're playing somebody you don't know their rank. Right. Mm-hmm. So sometimes we play without the belt system, so you don't know who you're playing. You know what I'm saying? So I think it adds the mystery to it. But also knowing when to speak and when not to speak with your body, with your movement.
It's all
a circle of creation. I got you.
Where are you practicing martial arts?
Oof. So Soul Rise Cultural Center, that's on East Utica right by the Meriwether Library. That's where I started out at. That was 6 years ago.
Oh, wow.
COVID kind of switched things up, so we're trying to get that back active. Until then, I'm teaching at PUSH. And then I'm teaching at the Reese Center.
Nice.
At PUSH means at the on Grand
Plymouth.
Street?
On Plymouth. I'm sorry.
On Plymouth.
That's a new location.
Oh, okay.
Plymouth.
Right. In the Plymouth. Well, they still have that old, but I don't know if they
library.
Do have any. No more programs for kids there.
There's nothing there. Yeah. Okay. It's dead empty.
Okay.
Unfortunately.
Wow. Okay. So it's all at Plymouth.
But down the street is the Reese Center, so I'm teaching there. And then
so you're basically west side.
I'm trying to explore back into the east side because that's where I'm from, Ryder Delta area.
Right.
So, you know, if people want to, like, reach out to me individually, I'll come teach, you know, wherever.
Space is the key.
Space is, indoor, outdoor, you know what I'm saying? The thing is, I don't need too much equipment.
Yeah.
You know, as long as I have enough space to teach, then I can teach.
So we should have you communicate with OSC.
Sure.
And we'll talk offline on that. And then they have the space.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's the old Chevy plant.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Oh, okay, cool.
And they're using it for resources for education, people for space for meetings.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that might be a place for you because they have to give back to the community.
Sure.
You know, these buildings and big corporations have to give back to the community. And I think, I don't know if we're talking about that as well, Vicky, on resources that we need to run our programs.
Sure.
All our programs are ran with our own funds.
Sure.
And so that presents a problem. And like you said, free.
Right.
He's doing free, but free is not free.
Mm-hmm. No.
It's at a cost, even with your organization
as
well.
Same difference.
Trying to find investors. Someone came into our office today.
Right.
South Vice Coalition office today.
Mm-hmm.
They were part of the FBI Citizen Academy, which I went through.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been seeing the work that I've been doing on the news.
Right.
And they said, okay, we want to give you something. Mm-hmm. Whether it was just a penny or whatever, I said, come to the office and meet with us.
Right.
They came into our office. They seen all the stuff that was on the walls and about homicide. And they presented us with a $500 check.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Wow.
And that $500 check goes a long way.
Sure.
For sure.
And the important part was that they sat there to listen, see what we wanted to talk about, and see how they can help us further.
Sure.
And any mission we do, any collaboration that we're trying to do.
Gotcha.
So I believe the key part of this, and I heard this show earlier with the young ladies, was people seems to be getting, quote, big money and not trying to spread it amongst the people that don't have
the grassroots.
Grassroots. And it's red tape. It's red tape for him. I wanted to give him $10,000 from, they just gave me $120,000, it's red tape. But it shouldn't be if we have the right people in place like Ayana and the others.
Right.
Say, let's figure this out. Let's get them up to speed. So now even if it's a non-for-profit or for-profit, that we can help each other out. And now our children in our community is getting a goal.
Because they need these programs. Yeah. They need
but
these
they can't
programs
get them
to support.
Because of the resource thing issue that we've been tugged at. And so now...
Even the Delavan Grider Center, you said you grew up in that area. Mm-hmm.
But then
they have a gym.
But
like,
then
it's red tape
to get there.
By red tape, what do you mean? It's like there's something that's
paperwork.
So it's a stipulation.
It's paperwork.
Somebody got something
and all that stuff.
Vicky has experienced that a lot. Somebody has a program going, right? And then you try to come in with your program. It's a good idea at first. Mm-hmm. And then, oh, we don't have the space. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? You're like, so, man, I got 15, 20 kids who just brought you your program to the community center mm-hmm. that you brought. Mm-hmm. And now you don't have the space. So now they get pushed out. Mm. And here we go. Now the kids get messed up.
I understand.
So what I need to say, you know, because there's so much to talk about here, and you're such great guests. We are almost out of time, so I just want to give everybody a chance, just like, you know, how people can get involved, or what, you know, how can people help or get more involved, and we'll just go right around. Everybody has like a minute, so Murray.
Well, like I said, take collaboration. You can call us at 854-1086. We're located at Back to Basics right now until our building is up and coming.
Right.
A is networking with a bunch of people.
Right.
I call her A. Because that's mm-hmm. the A team.
No, I know who you meant.
Yeah, and so from there, you will be hearing more about our organization. She will give you sites and all that there that's going on. I'm moving into the era of their era of more this here, not the paper.
Yeah.
Save trees.
Please do. Please.
Amen. Well, thank you. And thank you for all the work you do with Stop the Violence Coalition and the Peacemakers, Murray.
Right. Yeah. And so, just to piggyback off of what Stop the Violence has going on, we're doing summer campaigning starting June, and we're ending that all the way up till August 10th. Mm-hmm. We would love to see other nonprofits and community organizations come out and support us. Really, it's just enlightening the community on what it is that we have to offer all of our organizations, you know, and just tackling different parts of Buffalo. You know, from the north to the south, east, west, river bend, east side, west side, you know, just coming out and showing that unity and that coalition, that real community building.
Absolutely.
We do have an upcoming event over on River Bend, but yeah. As far as proactive programs to give these children and their parents and families mm-hmm. something to do, mm-hmm. We're doing restorative programs, urban agriculture. We have our GIVE program, which helps with probation. We just got a lot of programs that we're building on, and we would just love to see that community advocacy.
Right.
We have meetings all Fridays, every other Friday. So, come out and see us.
Thanks. Thanks. Nice.
Yep, and then Wakanda Alliance, find us at thegalactictribe.org. So the Galactic Tribe is our overhead group. That's the official 501c3 nonprofit.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. So still looking for funding and whatnot, but all the information is on our website, who we are, what we're about, upcoming programs. Usually it's every second and fourth Saturday, 12 p.m. at the King Urban Life Center, 938 Genesee Street. Next Saturday we'll be at a VillaCon, so we're doing a comic convention, giving out cards, trying to meet new students because we were blocked off from COVID, so we're getting back into the colleges and whatnot.
Right.
So, after that, we're going through the whole summer, so it's going to be a good time. So, come on out.
Super cool.
Yeah.
Sounds wonderful. Dope. Very, very good. Well, I want to say I couldn't be more grateful for all three of you coming out here, for all the work that you do all week long, and for our beloved community, because we've been talking peace, and together we are talking peace in truth and love.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Gratitude.
That was that.
What's up,
Thank
Vicky?
You so much. Very good.
You got his number, right?
Boy, never a dull moment.
I don't.
Pull up on me. And I'm not even expecting her. She'd pull up. Hey, I'm Ayana.
No. Okay, so I came for Nelson, to be quite honest.
Yeah. Okay.
So Nelson and I have worked together before. Nice. He taught that same...
You weren't there that Saturday. You were just here this last Saturday. The previous Saturday. Okay, that's right. I just knew I met you there especially when you said your name. And then when we started, when I said I thought, you know, I'd ask Anthony too. Then it's like, I did meet somebody named.
See, you think her name is not going to carry over. Right. And I'm like,
I got your partner's number too. She never texted me. I was like, okay.
She gave a cold shoulder. Then she's okay.
I don't know.
There we go.
No, she said good things about you.
I was like, oh, dang. I'm selfish. I hope I didn't scare her.